But today we're going to focus on some more familiar characters, Mary and Joseph. Now, last week we talked about a couple who, you know, they didn't plan this. They didn't look for anything. They prayed for a baby. But maybe those praying years just started waning away, because now they were a little too old to be doing this. But God answered that prayer. And the angel said, God has come to answer your prayer, and gave them a baby. But here we have a younger couple, and they're just looking to do something normal. Get married, have a family, live a life. Didn't say they were looking for anything more than that. Didn't talk about them trying to start a business. Didn't talk about them trying to do something huge or world impacting or changing the world. Nothing political, nothing there overthrowing the government, nothing about that. Just some regular, everyday people. And when we say young, Mary was, you know, probably 12, 13, maybe between the ages of 12 and 16. You know, that was the marrying age. And Joseph, he could have been an older guy, we don't know, or he could have been a younger guy, anywhere from probably 18 to 19, on up in years. We have no idea. But we know that they were obedient. So let's look at this story. If you go to Luke chapter 1. Now, when we think about them, I want you to think about a couple things. When God asked them to do something, he did not ask them to change who they were. Amen. He didn't even ask them to change what they did. He really told them to continue in what they were doing. So let's talk about this. In Luke 1, starting at verse 28, Luke 1:28. It says, the angel went to her being Mary, and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. That's on me. Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. I'm buzzing a little bit. Hold on. I'm ringing. Anything like that? I can go to this other one. Am I still ringing? Let's see. Okay. We better? We good? Yep, sound better. All right, starting over. Luke chapter 1. Is the ringing back? Y'all tell me. All right, let's just. I ain't finished. How about that? Oh, that sounds good. Listen to my voice. Hold on, hold on, hold on. Shh. Yes. Oh, that sounds good, huh? All right. Luke chapter 1. Starting at verse 28, the angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. And we know in other translations it says blessed and highly favored. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. That's not how people greet each other. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin? The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. She, who was said to be able to conceive, is in her sixth month. Remember, she was in hiding, right? For no word from God will ever fail. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word be fulfilled to me. Then the angel left her. Now, let's go over to Matthew 1. Let's go over to Matthew 1. Starting at verse 19, we see another gentleman, right? Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Okay, so we get two people in here. But after he had considered this, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, Son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. So we get two stories, one with Mary, one with Joseph, independently visited by an angel and given instruction on what to do. And we see that they're obedient to that instruction. What we are seeing also is, notice how when the angel told her, right, he said, you will have a son. And she said, how that's going to be? I'm a virgin. And he gave her explanation, and she said, okay. She didn't gripe, didn't push, right? She just said, okay. And then she said, I am a servant of the Lord. Now, that sounds a little far-fetched to me. If anybody tell me, oh, you're going to have the his, how? I got more questions. I need more answers. Yes, yes. So, after we look at this, we start to uncover some things. Now imagine for a minute if you were married, you're young, you haven't lived a long time, right? You're 12, maybe 16 at most. That's very young. And you're given this huge responsibility. And you live in a place where if this is true, you're unmarried, or you know, you're not married yet, they ain't got married yet. Here's a child coming. You risk being stoned.
Amen.
Thrown out, cast away, despised, looked upon. This is not a good thing. This is bad. Like, whoa, hold on. You want me to do what? And then you see, I got to tell my parents. What about my fiance? What about the world around us? How they going to look at me? What's going to happen to my name, my character? Everything that I stand for is being question right now.
Amen.
But for God's purpose, makes a little bit of a difference. And we see that for both of these individuals, for both Mary and Joseph, they're given a high responsibility. They're given something that we haven't seen in the scripture ever before. This miracle that is happening is very unique. This isn't something that just happens, right? This isn't something that we've seen in the Old Testament, or something that's, you know, the talking donkey or the axe head that rises in the water. Those were great. This is dealing with nature and the core of life. And this is how Jesus comes into the world, and he's going to use these people. Regular people. Didn't have any money. Didn't have any wisdom. From an age perspective, weren't looked at as scholars or anything like that. Just regular, everyday people. People in the crowd. So imagine, y'all seen these older movies, you know, where they go to the square and say Shakespeare time or Roman time, and it's just a bunch of mob of people just shopping and moving and hustling and bustling. Just pick two of them. Just pick a man and pick a woman. That's it. That's how regular these individuals were. Just co-stars, or what they call them, cast members, or what's the word I'm looking for? Extras, there you go, you knew it. Extras, just extras on the show. Just them two, give me them. And use them for a purpose that we could not foresee. And if you notice, you'll see there's some bookends on these scriptures that I want you to pay attention to. So if you go back to Luke 1, start at verse 28, it says, the angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Now notice in the next verse, she actually says, what kind of greeting is this? That was a question. Now what that translates to is you have been found to have grace, right? Grace has found you is really what that translates to. Grace has found you, Mary. God's grace has found you. But it comes with instruction. It comes with a purpose. Your favor to do something. And then he has this long conversation with her about what she is to do and what's going to happen. And notice in verse 38, which is the last verse in that particular conversation, she says, I am the Lord's servant. And then may your word to me be fulfilled. Then the angel left. Then turn over to Matthew 1. And we start at verse 19 with Joseph. And it says in verse 19, because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and he did not want to expose her, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. And then we know the angel came, right, talked to him. And then in verse 24, it says, when Joseph woke up, he did what? What the angel of the Lord had commanded him, and he took Mary home as his wife. So we see instruction given, and then we see obedience to the instruction in both of these individuals. So regardless of how young they were, how little money they had, they did have the opportunity to serve God's purpose, and they did it. They did it. And they were obedient to his purpose. That is what they did. So when we look at something like this, and we say, well, God, what do you require of me? Obedience. Look at all that we try to give to God. We try to give him our tithes and offering, which understood. We try to give him good tasks, you know, righteous living. We try to be the best person we can be. Look at me, God. Look at what I'm doing. Look at what I'm not doing. I'm not doing what they're doing. I'm not over here acting like they acting. I'm a good person. That's okay. That's good for other people to see. Who are you doing it for? Because I asked you to do something. Did you do that? Notice they didn't say, Mary, you so good. You do everything right. You so sweet. Joseph, you such a stand-up guy, a pillar of the community. People look up to you, like the way you dress, the way you talk. You don't steal or cheat. You a great person. I want to use you. He didn't say none of that. He just said Joseph. The only thing he knew about Joseph was his name. The only thing he knew about Mary was her name. That's all they had, their name. They didn't go through this long resume of how great an individual they were and say, you know what? You work so hard, you deserve to be graced by God. No. God's grace found them because of their obedience. They were obedient. That's all they had to give, obedience. And so we know that if they were obedient, because we know that they were young, we know that they were regular, and we know that they were poor. If you look in Luke 2, in 2 through 24, it talks about them giving an offering. Since they had a young child, right? And that was part of Leviticus. He gave an offering. Well, they gave two turtle doves. Well, in Leviticus, it tells you that when you're presenting, you can give a lamb. That's the requirement. But if you can't afford a lamb, which wasn't super expensive, but expensive enough, two turtle doves will do. So only the poor gave something like that. So we know that they didn't have much money, but they found a way to be used by God. How is that possible? That isn't how our society works. The world today tells me that God uses those who do good, who do right by themselves. He don't use the lowly. He uses people who look like they should be used. He uses people who I think he should use, because that look like somebody he'll use. Look at how that person's engaged. Look at how that person is really into the word. That person say they read their Bible 10 times a day, and that they pray 30 minutes a day, and that they done fasted and doing all this right stuff. That's a good person. I want my Christian walk to be like them. But the angel comes to you. Why? Because it ain't about that. It's about being obedient to God. Because the question I ask you, why are you doing all that fasting? Did God ask you to? Why are you doing all that stuff? Did God ask you to? And the things that God asked you to do, are you doing those things? It's good to pray. It's good to fast. It's good to read your Bible. But if you're not doing it with the purpose of serving God, close the book, get up, and go eat. Because it ain't meaning nothing. You have to be obedient to what God tells you. Mary was doing what she regularly did. Let's go back to Elizabeth. Elizabeth and Zechariah. We don't talk about four characters so far. Elizabeth and Zechariah were doing what they normally do. He was a priest. He went to the temple and prayed as was required by him. He wasn't going for himself. He was going because that was his job. And the angel came out of nowhere. Like, whoa, where did this come from? Here's Mary getting ready to get married. Joseph getting ready to go get her. And here comes an angel. It didn't say the angel came, Mary, you've been fasting and praying for so long. Mary, you've been doing this for so long. You've been focused for so long that I'm going to bless you. Mary was just living her life. Now, we love the story of Hannah. Why do we love the story of Hannah? Because it shows Hannah's dedication. It shows Hannah's focus, how she was doing so much, and then God blessed her. We love the stories of how we can be so good and get blessed from being so good. But we can't understand the story of how someone just goes on living and God finds them and uses them for however he gonna use them. Because it doesn't make sense. And it's not supposed to. And it's all in the greeting. Because the angel said, Mary, you who are blessed and highly favored. And she's like, what kind of greeting is this? Basically, he said, grace has found you. There is nothing you can do to find it, but it can find you. Guess what? When it finds you, it comes with a purpose. It comes with some structure. It comes with something that is going to result in positive things happening in your life. And God's grace has already found you. Because by Jesus being here, it's right there for you. And all you have to do is be willing to go for it, to do what God wants you to do, to live the life God wants you to live. And we said, well, I don't think God want me to have no baby. I don't know. Hope he don't want me to have no more. But if that's what it is, that's what it is. But that ain't your purpose for everybody, right? Don't be sitting here like, I'm up in age. I don't know if I'm having no baby. That's not what this lesson is about, okay? Don't go out here asking for no kid. Whatever God's purpose is in your life is for you. And you have to be willing to not let the world around you disguise or distort what he has for you because you are trying to please the world. What he asked of Mary was not going to make Mary look good at all. A lot had to go on. If Joseph wouldn't have been obedient, Mary been out there on her own looking bad, right, in that society. But God had a plan, and she was obedient to the plan. So that's to tell you, God's plan does not always look good to your friends. It may not look good to your church folks. Why are you doing that? If God asks you to do something, and you know God asked you to do it, don't go out there saying, I feel in my spirit. No. You need to know if God asks you to do it. Don't be sitting there wanting to do something so bad that you just, yeah, that feel right. I say it's God. Don't do that. But if God asks you to do it, do it. And do it wholeheartedly. And the blessings you will receive because of it will be awesome. We know that. It is said and it's tied and true. Let's look at Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, a lot of times we read verses like that and we see them words, good works, good works. And what do we think? Ooh, I got to be honest. I got to be truthful. I got to be faithful. I got to be kind. I got to be loving. I got to do all these works. But did you miss the next rest of it, which God prepared in advance for us to do? He's not going out there preparing for you not to lie. He ain't going out there preparing for you to make sure you tell the truth all the time and don't steal. He has a purpose for you that was prepared for you. So while you out there focused on this little stuff, you may be missing the big picture of the example that he set and what he has for you from a purpose of execution. You have to go out there and do what he has asked you to do, because he says, you are my handiwork. I created you for something. And guess what I want you to do? That something. And if you do that something, man, you will be in the right standards with what God wants you to do. Not all this what you think makes you look good. So when we look at the story of Mary and Joseph, we see two young people who are obedient to Christ and just do what he said. What God has asked them to do, they do. That's it. That's the story. I can't add anything else to it. Do this. Okay. The end of the story. And the blessings are there for the taking. The do this. Okay. We leave. They all live happily ever after. The end. Roll credits. That's a beautiful story to me. And that's your story as well. The problem is we keep adding subplots to it because we don't want to be obedient. Do this. Okay. Do some of it. Run through problems. Come back. Do this. Okay. Go through. Mess up. Come back. Do this. Okay. Go this. I need to go talk to the pastor. Go talk to the pastor. God said, oh, that's confirmation. He told me to. Try it. Come back. I need to go talk to my mama. Talk to your mama. Y'all see this? Over and over again. And this is just one chapter. We ain't even went to chapter two yet because you can't get out of chapter one. We want to get out of the first chapter. We trying to get to the end. We can't, because you keep not doing what God asked you to do. Mary made it simple. Do this. Okay. Angel left. Happily ever after. It's beautiful. And we know it's a lot more to the story, but y'all get what I'm saying. We have to be focused and do what God wants us to do, because he has something very special in your life just for you. Amen. And if you realize that, you can execute it and you can be exactly what he has dedicated you to be, created you to be, and designed you to be.